Hello everyone, welcome back to the next lecture on Introductory Organic Chemistry. I'm That Chemist, and welcome back. So today we're going to briefly follow up on the practice problems that I assigned last lecture, starting with ketamine. So here in blue, you can see this carbonyl here. This is a ketone because there's a carbon on either side. When we look at this amine group here, this is a secondary amine because there's a connection to carbon on both sides, but there's still one free NH. We also have this chlorine connected to this benzene ring, which we call an aryl chloride, as well as this benzene ring, which I've highlighted. After the examples, though, I'm not going to be highlighting that in the future, unless it's particularly relevant. In the second practice problem, we see another secondary amine. In Prozac, we also have two benzene rings, as well as an ether group, and alkyl fluorides. These are technically primary alkyl fluorides. Usually when we have multiple fluorines or multiple halogens connected to the same carbon, we would refer to them, in this case, as a trifluoromethyl group, because this whole motif may have some unique characteristics, but it wouldn't be wrong to call them alkyl fluorides, because they are. In this example of capsaicin, you can see that we have an alkene because the two carbons are on opposite sides for this disubstituted alkene. We call this a transalkene. We also have an amine connected to a carbonyl, which, if you'll recall, is an amide. Because there's one additional carbon coming off of the nitrogen, it's a secondary amide. We have yet another benzene ring. As such, you can probably tell at this point that this is quite a common functional group in organic chemistry. We also have this alcohol, which when connected to a benzene ring, we call a phenol, which I will only refer to as a phenol moving forward, as well as this methyl ether here. And if you're struggling to remember why it's an ether, just remember that there's a carbon on ether side. Okay, so I have a bit of follow-up from last time. So there's a couple other elements that are quite commonly encountered in organic synthesis that I had glossed over without giving them their proper attention. So silicon and tin, both elements beneath carbon, are quite prevalent in organic synthesis. Germanium has started seeing a bit of interest recently. Even though it's above tin, you'd think maybe germanium chemistry would be explored more, but it just turns out that that hasn't been the case as much. So some functional groups. So if we have a silicon connected directly to a carbon, we call that a silane. And so in this case, this is a tetramethyl silane. If we, instead of having it directly connected to carbon, we have the silicon connected to oxygen, we would call that a siloxane. And so in this case, this is tetramethyl siloxane. It's also okay to call it a tetramethyl silicate. If we have an alcohol that's instead of an OH bound to a silicon, so the OH of an alcohol has been exchanged for an OSI, we call that a silyl ether. And these are quite commonly seen in organic chemistry as protecting groups, which is a topic that we'll discuss in a much later video. Now, when it comes to tin, the most commonly encountered tin species is tributyl tin hydride, which is a common radical scavenger when combined with a radical activator. But occasionally you do see other examples of tin in organic synthesis. So even though tin is a metal, it acts more like a metalloid and it can be used as a reagent quite often. We tend to avoid these, though, due to the toxicity of tin-based reagents. Okay, so you've seen me draw a lot of molecules. How have I been drawing these? So the program that I use is one called ChemDraw, which in academia is the most common software for drawing molecules for anything from biology to chemistry, inorganic or otherwise. However, if you're just starting off as an undergrad, you might try ChemSketch. ChemSketch is an online chem drawing software. There's also a free online ChemDraw that you can find. It doesn't have quite all the features that the paid version has, but it might be able to meet the needs of your undergrad experience. There's a few other ones, but I would say that these are the two most common ones that you see used. Now, if you look at ChemDraw, one of the things you can do is you can draw a structure and you can just convert that structure directly to its name. So here we see tert-butyl benzene. So one advantage of getting the paid software is if you're not sure what the IUPAC name is, the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry, you can convert structure to name. And so even though in a lot of organic chemistry courses, you're taught how to name certain molecules, the most correct way to do this is to build a structure in an appropriate drawing software such as ChemDraw and convert structure to name. This is how all professors, all researchers get the actual name for molecules. And if you try to do it by the way you were taught, it's more likely than not wrong because IUPAC changes the accepted nomenclature from time to time. And so for the professors who took organic intro chemistry like 20 years ago, the way that they were taught is almost certainly wrong. So it's always better to double check a name with a tool like ChemDraw. An additional useful thing if you're using ChemDraw for research purposes is you can usually search these structures directly into a database such as ReAccess or SciFinder, and in some versions of ChemDraw you can even do it right into Google Patents. If there's an interest in seeing how to use ChemDraw in a future video, I would be happy to cover that. Okay, so moving to some other functional groups that I didn't totally cover in the previous episode. So when we have different lengths of carbon chains, alkyl carbon chains, aliphatic alkanes, we have different names for them depending on the number of carbons. I kind of alluded to some of these last time when I was talking about methyl esters or methyl groups. And so a methyl group is just when you have a one carbon unit. When here we have our R group again, where R is just something, we're not defining what it is, but it's something connected to this methyl group. If we have two carbons, we call that an ethyl group. If we have three carbons, we call that a propyl group. And if we have four carbons, we call that a butyl group. Now, in each of these cases, this is only the name if they're directly in that order. So if you change the connections to different points, they'd be called different groups. Some of those I'll discuss in a few minutes. When we have longer ones, such as like a five carbon chain, we call that pentyl. A six carbon chain is hexyl. Seven is heptyl. Eight is octyl. Nine is nonyl. 10 is decyl. And so on. There's other ones. 11 is undecyl, 12 is dodecyl, but for the most part, you only really need to know up to 10 or so. Sometimes you'll see these drawn in their expanded formulas. However, most of the time we'll draw them in bond line formulas. I've also indicated here that for methyl groups, if you just have a single methyl group like connected to R or something, it's usually better to explicitly label the CH3 just so people can tell what it is and not like you made a mistake or something. It's just more clear to see. So if you ever end something in a methyl, it's worth considering just drawing it as a CH3 for convenience. Okay, so what if we have a propyl group connected differently? So here you can see instead of connecting at the primary position, if we connect to the propyl at the secondary position, we call that isopropyl. So like isopropyl alcohol, for instance. Now, if we're drawing this in the expanded formula, when we put parentheses around a substituent, that just means that it's coming off of the carbon that we were just talking about. So this is quite a common notation that you'll see in papers and textbooks. Here, if we extend this by one carbon, this is an isobutyl group. Now, because butyl has an additional carbon, there's many different ways that butyl could be connected to an R group. So here's a tert-butyl group, where you can see this carbon has three methyl groups sticking off. And additionally, if we move one of those carbons down here, we have a sec-butyl group. And this is how the expanded formula is written. And it can be a little bit confusing to look at these, so it's good practice trying to write out what they look like for more complex molecules. I personally prefer the visual format because you can see exactly what it is, whereas you have to figure out what it is from the expanded formula in your brain, which is not easy, especially when you start off organic chemistry. Now, there are some other organic groups that are worth knowing by name. So we've been talking about benzene rings as phenyl or aryl groups. But when we have a benzene ring with another aliphatic carbon, an aliphatic carbon directly connected to it, we call that a benzylic position. And so this whole group is called a benzyl group. If we don't have that aliphatic carbon there and the R group is just directly connected to the benzene ring and there's nothing on the benzene ring, then we call it a phenyl group, which we abbreviate as PH. Now, if there's anything else on the benzene ring, it isn't really appropriate to call it a phenyl group. It is still a phenyl, but it's more generally an arene. An arene is just a benzene ring with stuff on it. So we call that an aryl group, which you can abbreviate to AR, which is also the short form for argon, but it's still commonly enough used. Okay, So kind of like we have benzylic, if instead of a whole benzene ring, we just have an alkene there, we call that an allyl group. And the reason we specify what those are is allylic groups do unique chemistry that we're going to talk about in a later episode. Similarly, if instead of having an alkene, we have an alkyne, we call this a propargyl group. And so it's just worth becoming familiar with these as we encounter them so that we know what we're talking about. Okay, so let's go to a couple examples for functional group identification. So here we have ibuprofen, aka Advil, which I know personally I've taken many times in my life. Here we can see that there's an isobutyl group, right? You can count the carbons 1, 2, 3, 4, that's isobutyl. We can also see that this is benzylic because there's an alkyl group connected directly to a benzene ring. This other position here would also be a benzyl group, but for simplicity I've just highlighted one of them. Here we have a methyl group coming off of this benzylic position, and we also have a carboxylic acid group. There are many different NSAIDs that are available for treatments of inflammatory pain, such as headaches and such, but ibuprofen has been over the counter for so long that it's probably the most common one that younger people take at least. Okay, here's another example. This is propofol, which if you haven't heard of before, it's an anesthetic that they usually give for some surgeries. It is also famously the drug that Michael Jackson overdosed on and ultimately led to his death. His personal doctor administered it to him, but he OD'd, and that was the end of Michael Jackson. When I got my wisdom teeth out when I was younger, this was the drug that they gave me to put me under during my surgery, and it was very trippy. I remember being just totally out of it. I just didn't remember what happened, and then I was in a different room. And when I started realizing I was in this different room, I'm like, oh, what happened? And then my mom was there, and then I was outside, and then I was at a rock store. And then later in the day, I had all of the memories of the doctors operating in my mouth just flash through my brain in like a matter of seconds, and it was like my whole day flashed before my eyes. So this is a crazy molecule. Very, very small molecule for a drug, but it's an interesting one. They call it milk of amnesia because you totally forget what happens when you're on it, when you're like unconscious. So it suppresses memory and it makes you unconscious, and they're not totally clear about the mechanism. But looking at the structures here, we can see that there's 2-3 carbon chains, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. Those are the isopropyl groups. They also give the prop of propofol its name. We also have the phenol, which is the alcohol here, and it's connected to a benzene ring. Also, you can see because we have an alkyl group directly bound to a benzene ring, that's technically a benzylic isopropyl group. Here is another example. So this is Norelgestromin, which is birth control. Here you can see there's a number of different functional groups worth highlighting. If you recall from last episode, when we have a C double bond N, but there's an OH sticking off of it, that's called an oxime. And sometimes when we do chemistry, we get a mixture of products. And so here, this squiggly line means that this product is a mixture of the OH point pointing one way and pointing the other way. But we just do the squiggly line to simplify that so we don't have to draw the whole thing twice. Here you can also see that there's a double bond with three substituents. So we call that a trisubstituted olefin or a trisubstituted alkene. We also have this cyclohexane ring shown in orange here, the cyclopentane ring drawn in purple. We have an ethyl group, which might be a little bit hard to see. We have an alkene sticking off of this tertiary alcohol. And that's this molecule in a nutshell. So before the next episode, I would encourage you to do a few more practice problems. Here I've just included some interesting examples. Naloxone, which is used for opioid overdoses, which is especially important given the ongoing opioid crisis in North America, with fentanyl especially. Here's a drug used for the treatment or prevention of HIV. This is efavirenz. It's got some unique things going on. See if you can come up with the names for those groups. We also have CBD, which is used in many consumer oils for treatments or personal use. There's also some interesting groups here. And so hopefully this has been useful for you. If you have any questions, I'd encourage you to leave a comment in the comment section. And like I said last time, if you have any suggestions for formats, I'd be happy to listen and hear them out. If you want to leave a like and subscribe, I'd appreciate it. And otherwise, have a great day.